say hello, Paul. Thank you so much for taking time to sit down for this interview with me today. I'm really excited, as you know, to talk. We have so much to talk about. But before we jump into all the Phil Collins stuff, I want to talk a little bit about you. Your career is, to say extraordinary is an understatement. Paul Flattery is best known in the Phil Collins world as the man behind the many Phil Collins and Genesis music videos that that we've seen, that we all watch on YouTube. During his Phil years, his partner in crime was Jim Yukich, who served mostly in the role of director. And together, their company Split Screen and Flattery Yukich Inc., or FYI, was responsible for most of the content that that I know I watch all the time. But Paul has actually done and is doing much more. He's a four-time Emmy and three-time Grammy-nominated producer and writer. Of TV specials currently, but earlier in your career, earlier music video producer and journalist. Your recent TV productions, the 2023 Critics' Choice Awards, the White House Correspondents' Dinner, that was this year, Thanksgiving Day Parade, the Live 8 concerts, Live Earth, which I think Genesis played, was that year doing?
Yeah.
You did the concert for New York City, which was amazing, and also won some awards. You produced the Billboard Music Awards for 12 years, Kids' Choice Awards for 18, the CMT Awards, Miss America, Daytime Emmys, the Hero Dog Awards, and the American Cinematheque Award for 26 years running. It's incredible. Well, I can't talk about your career not mention the music specials. Music is what I love. You've produced legendary artists, including David Bowie, Tina Turner, Crosby, Stills, Nash, Stephen Stills and Neil Young, Willie, Bonnie Raitt, four Phil Collins specials, Joe Cocker, Charlie Pride. I mean, the list goes on and on. Guys, we're getting to listen to a super bigwig in the industry, and we're very fortunate. Your current company, which is a full-service production company for TV specials and TV series, you founded it in early 96. It's called Mercy Masala. Hopefully I'm saying that correctly. Is there any significance or meaning to that name for you that you can share with us?
Oh, yes. Well, Mercy, because I come from Liverpool, and my wife is Indian or half Indian. Her father was from Burma and her mother's from Finland. So she's this very exotic mix. And so we thought, Mercy Masala was alliterative. And, masala means a mix.
Your primary role, I think, throughout the things that we're going to talk about today was as producer. But what is a producer's role? What is it that you do as a producer?
Well, the producer is basically responsible for everything. Mm-hmm. So you're the person that everybody comes to with questions, with complaints, mm-hmm. and all that stuff. So, and you're the one who essentially, with help, obviously, organizes the whole thing. The director's job is to shoot and capture what it is on film or on tape. But he, if a director says, I need an elephant, it's my job to go and get the elephant. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it depends on the relationship between a producer and a director. It changes in film where, film and music videos where they're kind of seen as the more creative part. But in television, it's the other way around. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of why, I'm in television, because that way, we producers come up with most of the creative and everything. And then basically you choose a director to come in and execute your vision. Mm-hmm. So they can obviously, they add stuff of their own.
Mm-hmm.
So with Jim and I, it was, in my case, with all my directors, I was always involved creatively. And, sometimes it would be entirely my idea, sometimes it would be entirely theirs, and sometimes it would be something you work out.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And, that's been the case with every director I worked with.
Right. It sort of varies depending on the circumstance, I suppose.
Yeah.
As I said, you've worked with so many legends, and we don't have time to talk about them all, but if you'll indulge me, there were a few things that I dug through in what you did that I really want to ask you about. One of my all-time favorite Michael Jackson songs is Rock With You. And you worked on that in 1979. And Michael was pretty young still on Rock With You. What was it like working with Michael then?
It was very straightforward. Since it was just him, there wasn't, it was basically him and us. And he was not as shy as he became later. And, you know, he was just very low key, and he would come alive when the cameras rolled. I mean, Michael was much more animated on the phone than he was in person. You know, I think he had an issue with a one-on-one. In fact, when Phil was hosting Billboard for me one year, we had to fly up to Neverland to give him an award, you know, and Phil kind of didn't want to go. He was like, oh, Buddy Holly, you know. And so we, unfortunately, it was a nerve-wracking journey up there. We got caught in clouds and it was raining and the helicopters going all over, and Jill, his wife, and his daughter, Lily, in the back. And water started coming through where the propeller is. And it wasn't a fun journey. Yeah. But when Phil met up with Michael, Michael was more interested in talking to Lily and taking her upstairs to his toy room than he was talking to Phil. You know, Phil then and I, we went up to where we were setting up and basically then just chatted about what we were doing. And then about an hour later, we called Michael to come over and presenting him with an award.
Okay.
Forget what it was for now, but one of the records. It was for a Billboard record that he'd set.
Yeah. I remember Phil talks about that in his book. So one of my favorite guys, singing wise, is Steve Perry. And you produced Oh Sherry, which I think was his first solo video.
It was.
Yeah, and I heard that Steve, and I don't know how true this is, I heard he's a bit difficult to work with, but what I found pretty funny rewatching the video as I was getting ready for this, I watched all the things we're talking about, is the video sort of makes fun of that he's difficult in a way. And I think it's a really clever storyline. And you were credited, well, you wrote the screenplay and you're also credited as an actor, but I couldn't pick you out in there. So you have to tell me who you were, but tell me a little.
I rip up the script when he goes off script.
Okay, cool.
I'm playing the writer. But no, Steve was wonderful. He was, you know, just, I'm still friendly with him today. And when I was doing a concert with Neil Young and Stephen Stills, he came by and we had a nice chat. He was nothing but great, a pleasure to work with.
Well, that's good news. So you chose, you can't always believe what you hear about people.
Right. Sure. But certainly with Steve, the first one, Sherry, was trying to say, look, here's this guy, and all this stuff is being foisted on him. And he just kind of like ultimately being kind of like says, I can't deal with this.
I was watching the video. Actually, last night I was watching the video and I actually got a little weirdly emotional, although I get emotional a lot, when he's finally sitting in the hallway and his voice is so incredible. And he just sings. I think it's a cappella. You should have been gone.
You should have been gone. Knowing how I made you feel, and I should have been gone.
And it made me emotional. And I just thought, God, I haven't seen this video in years.
Well, the one after we did after that was Strung Out.
Uh-huh.
And we shot that as a prequel so that it would actually be, as I like to call, a suite. So the two videos would bookend and could be played in one continuous thing and make sense that it was a story.
Now, picture this. Romeo and Juliet, Camelot. Steve, Oh Sherry must be an epic.
Are you serious?
Absolutely. We open with a fanfare of trumpets from the balcony.
But there's no trumpets in my song.
Then we'll just have to add them.
So in Strung Out, we have Steve in rehearsal and the director comes in. And, you know, we made the director, or, you know, very sinister through the backlighting and some certain shots. And he was modeled on Strelnikov from Dr. Zhivago.
Oh, I actually haven't seen, I don't know if I've seen it. I'm going to have to watch those, and I'll watch Strung Out first and then
yeah,
go and watch. That's pretty cool.
Flaming Forests of Doom.
Flaming Forests of Doom, Steve.
Flaming
Forests of Doom. Forest.
Not a flaming forest of doom, Steve.
Forest of Doom.
That's the line. You know, he's like, Steve, the flaming forests of doom. And it was...
anyway.
I mean, one of my most famous videos is Jack and Diane. And that was literally, we were shooting, rolling homemade films off the edit bay wall. And the switcher, you can see those thick borders. That was what the switches were like in those days. Very crude, very crude. But went number one.
This is fantastic. That song, I'm going to sound like a big crybaby. That part in that song, hold on to 16 as long as you can. Changes come around real soon. Make us women and men.
Hold on to 16 as long as you can. Changes come around real soon. Make us women and men.
It moves me every time. I don't know what it is. I think I am a nostalgia prone or something. But looking back on your career, and I know you're still doing it, but so far to date, is there any particular artist, any one or two that stand out as having been a thrill for you? Maybe you had anticipated or upon meeting them realized, wow.
Well, no, certainly Bowie. Bowie was unmistakably, you know, he was just incredible. I mean, he was open to your suggestions. He was always polite. He was always, you know, nice. And, you know, it was working with him. I did about six songs of his, and he was on the concert for New York City, you know, which he opened for us. I mean, he was brilliant. You're always kind of like intimidated by somebody like Jagger. And a lot of times people who, you know, you think are going to be good are not. I mean, there's obviously a lot of people who were my idols. I managed to work with Little Richard, you know, and worked with Ray Charles and B.B. King, you know, a lot of these people, and they're fantastic. And I often say that the people like Bowie and Elton and Billy Joel and all these, you know, they're going to be seen as the Mozarts and the Bachs of our time, and it's an incredible honor to work with them, to have worked with them. I was from Liverpool. The Beatles were obviously our big hometown heroes. So I never met John, but I did. I've worked with Paul, George, and Ringo, and that's always a thrill. I mean, you know, you've got to kind of always. But other than that, Bowie certainly was the major one.
Moving kind of on to your partnership with Jim Yukich, it resulted in some spectacular work. And after reading about what you guys did together, it seems to me it was really a sweet spot in your career. You guys did so much cool stuff. I wanted to ask you to tell me the story, which I think I'm right about this. The story sort of will take us into Easy Lover and the beginning of your relationship with Phil Collins.
Well, I've been through many partnerships in music videos. And at this time, a lady at CBS, Debbie Newman, said to me, there's a guy who came to see me. I think he's a really good director. You should think about working with him. And his name was Jack Cole. And he had a couple of really good videos on his reel. And he'd actually done things like the opening sequence to $6 Million Man and some other big iconic TV series. So we got together and we did a video for Philip Bailey, and it was called I Know. And essentially the video, we actually broke the cardinal rule, which is that you don't fuck with the music, because that's what everybody's selling. They're selling that record. Mm-hmm. And they don't want you to mess around with it. We put dialogue into the instrumental passage, and we won an award for it. And anyway, so Jack was good. And then suddenly it was so good that this huge company, PMI, poached him. And they said, you know, you're going to come and work for us. And he said, well, I've got my producer, Paul. And they said, yeah, he can work with you. So he was signed to a contract. I wasn't. But it was PMI, and PMI, which was Capitol Records. But we used to go into the LA office, and there was a guy there, Jim Yukich, who'd come up through the mail room, and he worked his way up to director. He was sent out to oversee a video with David Bowie, and he ended up helping out so much, Bowie gave him the solo credit, which was Modern Love. And so he was becoming a director, and his concern was that he was only being seen as a performance director, and he wanted to be seen as a conceptual one. And I was one seen as conceptual. So he wanted to work with me. Then what? So, you know, it's like, okay, we'll work it out. But then when Easy Lover came along, Philip Bailey wanted Jack Cole to do it. And Phil, who'd worked with Jim on, they'd done That's All, and Jim had done the Mama concert. You know, he wanted Jim. And the record label sort of compromised by having me and Jim do it. But the idea they had was somebody else's. I don't know where it came from. Mm-hmm. And so they said, okay. So we said, fine. And as we're flying over to England, Jim says to me, Phil's not going to do this. And I said, what do you mean? He says, well, look, this concept they've got, it's basically Philip going all around London. And wherever he goes, he meets Phil. Phil's the taxi driver. Phil's the hotel doorman. Phil's the guy who's selling the newspapers. Phil's the guy taking the tickets, you know. He says, and it's in the winter, and it's cold and damp, and he's finishing his record. He's not going to want to do it, I'm telling you. So I said, all right, so what are we going to do? So we concocted this video within a video idea. And that's what we did. We ended up doing for Easy Lover. And then basically Philip's management was, and this came off Philip's album, remember? Not off Phil's album. It wasn't on No Jacket Required, which Phil was finishing up at the time. So the management said, look, this is looking like a Phil Collins video with Philip Bailey. And we want it to be a Philip Bailey video with Collins, which is what the record was. Philip got first billing on the record. Phil had written it with him and Philip and had produced it. But so we concocted this like big entrance. We thought, well, you know, what better than arrive at the studio by helicopter? That kind of says, look, this is an important person. So we took Philip up in a helicopter, and it was a little rocky for him, and he turned green, but luckily it didn't come out that way in the film. So he lands and comes in, and then Phil comes in. And so we kind of like were filming the filming of the video and doing some video bits. And we would set up a couple of situations, like we had the idea for the Earth, Wind & Fire costume ahead of time, obviously, so we got the costume. But a lot of it was just made up on the spot. And it was, you know, having so many kind of crews and filming it as you're going along, since you're filming all the time, you're getting all the material without wasting everybody's time, saying, all right, stop, let's reset the lights here, we'll do this, bring that, you go away for an hour, we'll be ready. You know, it's like all happening. And, you know, I think what we got was, we managed to get their relationship, we managed to get their, you know, their personalities, and we got their music. And so it was, you know, it was a fun video, which inadvertently, Jim and I are in the beginning, as you see again, which is not a thing we were trying to do by any means.
No. I've always wanted to ask this. The guy, Philip Bailey, is holding the lyric sheet and they're singing. And I always tell everybody, oh, look at them, they're singing live. That's amazing. They're amazing singers. You can hear them harmonizing. She's an easy lover. She'll take your heart, but you won't feel it. She's like no other. And I'm just trying to make you see. But I never knew if what I was saying was actually true, and I was just making it up. Were they live?
Yeah.
And you just captured it. And and it just happened. It was just that. I mean, it wasn't, you didn't script that, and they didn't rehearse it necessarily. No,
what you do is you got to go in with situations. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, you say, okay, we'll shoot you. Let's have Phil in the makeup chair. Let's have, you know, rehearsing the dance moves, you know, that kind of stuff, you know. So, you know, right. We just had a long list of things to shoot. And and obviously we shot a, like it was a TV show that they had to go and do.
So. Yeah. Did you plan on using the live audio of them singing, though, is what my always question was. Or was it just meant that they, to look like they were singing the song, but you weren't going to use that audio, you were going to use the recording?
No, we always planned on adding in some, again, you know, breaking the cardinal rule.
Right. Because it's fantastic. It's fantastic. And, you know, and Phil Collins has, I think, well, at least back then, had kind of a high voice. I'm the only person that could out high Phil Collins is Philip Bailey, right? I mean, and the harmony was so cool. I love it. And I love the
opening. Philip is a great guy. Philip is a lovely, lovely guy.
So talented. Amazing.
And every time I see him now, we have a big hug, and even today, you know?
Yeah, he's so great. All of that. That video is so popular. When anytime you talk about it, people love it. It's one of those things that just people love. Like, you're part of our cultural sort of, you know, it's an iconic video, really.
I think because we're not trying to pretend to be anything other than it is.
Yeah, and they're so funny. Like the two of them. There's the part where they do the, I guess it's probably like a Temptations Four Tops kind of thing, where they're doing the mic swap. Phil Collins actually looks rather irritated. Was that a shtick, or was he actually irritated?
Because it wasn't working. Mock irritation. Another funny thing about that video was that Phil's wife, Jill, called us and said, she'd seen on the television this guy who was a Phil lookalike. Yeah. So we should like use him. So we thought, okay, we'll get this guy. Maybe we'll shoot him as the helicopter pilot. Uh-huh. So Philip gets in the helicopter, is in the helicopter, and he's like, Phil? Like he was, and anyway, so the guy turned up, and I don't know if anybody's ever said to you, you've got to see this person because they look just like you. And then you look at them and you go, that's what you think I look like? That's kind of what happened with Phil. So he didn't want this guy in. So we didn't.
Oh, that's terrible. Did you think that the guy resembled Phil Collins or no?
Oh, in a way, but not like you'd ever, if you put them both together, you wouldn't say which one's Phil.
Okay, got it. Yeah. Because I was going to say to you, are there any pictures of this guy around? Because I have to see him, see what
I don't know. I don't know.
No, that's funny.
I used to always get taken for Gene Wilder when I was young.
Oh, yeah. I can sort of see it in the eyes, I think.
And obviously, he was older than me. And then it became Sammy Hagar. And then it became Robert Plant.
Oh, I have to ask about the funny part. When the guys are dancing, you know, and Philip Bailey just has all the moves. Did you know Phil was going to do the thing where he shook his whole lower body? Or was that completely just...
No, that was him doing, he was doing Ed Grimley.
Oh, that's what it was.
Saturday Night Live. I think that's what he was doing. Uh-huh.
Oh yeah, he was so funny. That cracked me up. I thought that surely that has to be completely, you know, just extemporaneous. It wasn't planned, right? I mean...
He is funny. I mean, Phil is funny. And as a kind of a joke also, because he drove himself there. Mm-hmm. You know that what they call, I think they call it over here, the Denver boot, that when you're parked illegally, they come and put this thing on your car. And so we had a fake one built and we put it on his car. So we said, bye, Phil. Bye. Great.
Was he like super annoyed?
He saw it as a joke. He saw it as a
joke. Oh my gosh, that's so funny. So,
and so we kind of like instantly had that kind of relationship with him. And that went on throughout the whole, you know, time that we worked with him.
Yeah, I mean, I think you worked with him through, I think, was Wake Up Call the last video?
No, I think Brother Bear was the last one.
You're right, Brother Bear. Was that his last video too, Phil's? I think it talked about
that wasn't his last, because Jim, when Jim and I split up, Jim actually went and worked with him. And he had this, Jim had this idea, which he got Phil to agree to do it. And what it is, it's like just their heads on tiny bodies.
It always reminded me of that character from the, I think it was in Living Color, the Wayans brothers. It was the head detective. Do you ever remember that? It was a giant head with little feet. Just after Easy Lover, Jim Yukich came to you with some news that would actually change your lives.
Originally it was that Phil wanted to shoot like 4 or 5 concerts all at different places in the world. So basically it got changed to, we're thinking of having you come on the world tour. Mm-hmm. And so that was like, wow, you know, obviously a 6-month commitment. And you know, it wasn't a total, we weren't on the tour the whole time. Tony said, well, let's go do Scandinavia and Northern Europe, see how we get on. Mm-hmm. And then if we get on all right, we'll think about the rest. So it was done as a kind of a step deal. But mm-hmm. Nevertheless, it was still enough for us to say, we're gonna leave and form our own company.
You had mentioned in something I was reading that you all worked with Phil and you had such a relationship that you didn't have to have contracts in place, right? Because no, there was that respect. Yeah.
It was with Tony Smith, and we never had a contract. I mean, we did, you know, like 60, you know, I don't know how, what it is. It's like, you know, 60 or 70 projects with them. And we never had a contract.
Spectacular, isn't it? I mean, it's really,
it is. I mean, Tony Smith is a great guy. He's a smart guy, really smart. Yeah. And you know, the fact that he would just do it on, you know, I guess the thing is, look, if anything came down, I mean, they've got so much money, they can crush you, you know, cockroach. They don't need any stinking paper to do that. So you didn't really have that record company interference on the video concepts, which was kind of a good thing, because, you know, you really want to, well, you know, although they're the ones selling it, you know, but by and large, it was great just to deal with the artist.
That gave you more freedom too. I mean, to ultimately create something that was so unique, and we'll get there. Well, we won't get there this interview because I'd like to do it again with Genesis with you if this goes well and you put up with me. But, you know, Land of Confusion, say, you know, which I think that was a pretty progressive video, and all of the characters and so forth. You probably couldn't have done that if the record company was in your business, so to speak, but I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, originally, I mean, one of the dirty little secret of certainly Jim and I's career in music videos is we never threw an idea away. Mm-hmm. If somebody didn't want it, we just kept the idea and looked, and, you know, because we believed in our ideas. Mm-hmm. So the Land of Confusion was originally an idea for Jeff Beck.
Oh, wow.
And his manager said, this is too political for us. Mm-hmm. So he passed on it. Mm-hmm. So we, you know, and as you'll learn as we talk about the others, some other art concepts that we did with Phil were originally for other people.
Mm-hmm. You guys were going to do the first leg of the 85 tour. But before you did that, you made Susudio on One More Night. And I learned something that I never knew. And I want you to share that with our audience. And I wonder how many people know about the fact that that is a suite of videos.
We did that because we knew we had to do this program called Album Flash, which was Cinemax, which is a subsidiary of Showtime. And it was kind of more than, I don't know, I forget now. It's quite a while. But so we wanted to do the two videos so that they would play as one, but they would both play separately if needed. Mm-hmm. And this was going back, this is what we did with Strung Out and Oh Sherry. But in the case of Susudio on One More Night, it was very, very natural. It was a very easy thing. although it cost me a broken nose.
Ah, yes.
That transition cost me a broken nose. If you look at music videos, people often say to me, well, where'd you get your ideas from? And I say, oh, there's a book. There's a book. It's called 1001 Music Video Ideas. And they say, oh, where can I get it? So there isn't a book. But there are a lot of tropes. There are a lot of cliches, you know, that get used over and over. You know, one of them is always the kind of the thing at the end, the turning thing, which is like, oh, but was it a dream? You know, kind of thing. And so one of the obvious things is people aren't really enjoying stuff until an artist plays. And then they all get up for Michael Bolton or for John Mellencamp or whoever. Yeah. You know, so Phil said, I've never actually had a video where people are seen to enjoy my music. I would like that. So we came up with the idea of him being in a pub band, because in England there was the pub rock was a thing. And we found this pub that was actually owned by his record label, Virgin Records, called Princess of Wales. And by some, I don't know how we did it, but we managed to get them to close down. So we closed it down, and we had Phil and we had extras, and everybody sitting around bored, and you know, until Phil says, all right, let's play Sussudio, isn't it? And Sussudio gets them all going. And so the idea was, at the very end, the audience just dissolves out. So it's a fixed frame. The audience dissolves out until there's nobody there. And then we discover just Phil, Don Myrick, and the bartender are left. So we had to lock off this camera and get everybody out. And so we'd get them out. Then we'd say, okay, stay out. All right, now everybody back in and we'll start all over again. Well, one time, I have to step back a second. The pub decided to let in some of their regulars. And of course we had served alcohol to our extras just to get them loose and going, you know? And so some of the regular patrons had probably taken advantage of the no cost bar. And as they were all people coming out on one take, this guy is trying to push his way in. And I just like said, can't go in. And suddenly next minute, there's blood spurting out of my face. And I'm staggering, and people grab him, and they threw him out, and then they said, you need to go to hospital. So I went to hospital, and then they said, you got to have stitches. It was right in the nose, right on the bridge of my nose. And so I actually couldn't even be there for the next day's shoot, which was one more night. So my wife, Karen, who was the production manager, she took over in my absence, and they finished that video. So yes, I get my nose broken, and it made the papers, made big, big headlines. Phil's, I've got it up here. Oh. Phil's top video.
Oh, that's cool.
Is it backwards?
Oh, look at that. No, it's straight on. I can see it. That's awesome.
So it's Phil's top video, and it's completely full of lies, which is, but who would be astonished at that from the British press? So it says the wife of rock superstar Phil Collins was recovering last night after being punched in a pub. First of all, so she wasn't punched. A gang of drunks waded into the attack as Genesis singer Phil made a video. There was no gang, it was the one guy. Producer Paul Flattery was punched to the floor and taken to hospital with a broken nose. Okay, I wasn't punched to the floor. I stood my ground, but I did get a broken nose. And so it was just like, Phil didn't even, his wife was hurt. Phil didn't even know this had happened till he was driving into the shoot and he heard it on the radio.
Oh my God. And then he heard that his was hit. Meanwhile, no such thing. And how would they even have come up with that? Did you have long hair and someone thought it was you or his wife? I mean, how was that?
I never thought of that. Maybe.
So do you have a scar there?
No.
No.
They did do it in this black. I had black eyes for a while and had black stitching. So typical NHS.
So did you ever find out, was the guy one of the regular local guys?
Yeah, he was a regular.
Did he apologize or?
No.
No, you never saw him again though. No.
Just one more night is basically you got a sex solo. Right.
And then there's the bartender. And so that's sort of, it's a continuation of it. Of that.
And that's so the after the performance, the audience is gone. Barman's, locking up the bar, and Bill and Don just sing the song.
We get to talk about Take Me Home now. Now, is Take Me Home one of those videos that you often hear from people? That's my favorite video. That's the best video. Do you hear that a lot?
No, it's one of my favorites.
Oh, it's
because obviously it's like revisiting, going around the world, and we have such great memories from all those different countries that we went to.
It's a spectacular video. I have so many questions about it. I saw a really neat picture that you showed me, and it was something from the hotel stationery. The lyrics of the song and all the planning. And it never ever occurred to me until I saw that, oh my God, these guys had to sit there and think about, all right, when we're in whatever city, he has to sing this line and whatever. I mean, that's pretty cool. Tell me a little bit more about that. Did sometimes the line make a difference? The snowball one, of course, that line made sense to be out in the cold when he was singing that line, but is that how you did it, or how did you guys plan that out?
Yeah, it was planned out. It wasn't really planned out till we got to Gothenburg. And that's why it's on that hotel station of me, as you can see. So we, Jim went through and just marked out where, because we knew when we were going to film this around the world, we wouldn't have Phil for that long, so we couldn't really have him to do the whole fucking song in every place. Right. So we just worked it all out, which stanza he would do, and then we just have him do a couple of the choruses, and then we could put them in anywhere. Mm-hmm. So that's what we did. And wherever we went, going on tours is incredibly monotonous, and it's very, it's the same thing over and over. It's like bus from the hotel to the airport, flight to the next airport, bus from the airport to the hotel, check in, bus to the venue, sound check, bus, after the sound check, stay in, have the meal, do the concert, bus to the hotel, meet in the bar for drinks. Yeah. Get up, do it all over again. Literally, that's what it's like on tour. And for Phil, we'd have to catch him before they would go to the venue. And so to make it as minimum as possible, we would find our location, we would set up our crew, our 35 mil crew. And because we shot it on 35, we were shooting our documentary on Super 16. So it meant we had to carry all this extra equipment, which was real pain, but the better quality. And so we would find the location, set it all up, and then when we were ready, we'd call back to the hotel. Phil would come with his bodyguard, step in, sing the lines, get out, back to the hotel, and we'd break down. So really, it was supposed to be the minimum convenience as possible for him.
Right.
As it happened, as we were going along, sometimes he would say, I don't want to do today because of whatever. Copenhagen was so cloudy, you couldn't even see anything. So, foggy. So there was no point in doing it. And he didn't, he was always protective of his throat. He would go to steam rooms as much as he could. And because he would do, the sound checks were almost as long as the concert.
Yeah, it's amazing.
And Phil was such a worker that after the concert, you know, he would take the board tapes home, soundboard tapes, up to the hotel. And on the bus, on the way to the plane, he'd be going around to everybody and giving them notes from the previous night's show. I mean, so he'd sat there and listened to the whole fucking show again.
I've heard that. I heard one of the guys was telling me that sometimes they would get a fax. They would slide under the hotel room door and they'd see it. And I said, come on, Phil Collins is not running around the hallways putting faxes under. But he said, no. You know, the hotel staff, you know, Phil has faxed it from wherever, you know. And okay. But yeah, that's that. I've heard that story before. Interesting. Did you ever get a note on tour?
No, we got, well, he told us the notes. He would tell us in no uncertain terms if there was, like, for instance, when we were doing the documentary, if there was a big problem, he would say, out, you know, and for us to get out. Mm-hmm. And even though, you know, we'd said, look, we're working for you, you own this, this isn't going to go anywhere unless you want it to, why don't you let us film it in case you want it used? He'd go, no.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then when it came down to shooting the concert in Dallas, he said, and remember that he said, I want a film of a gig, not a film gig. So we were, you know, in other words, we don't want to do anything that's going to upset the audience. Even though we would say to him, look, wherever we go, when we do music videos at concerts, the audience goes nuts because, you know, the artist has chosen them to be in their video for that. They love it. And in some cases with, you know, bands like REO Speedwagon, we play the same song like 3 or 4 times in the middle of the concert to playback. Yeah. So, and the crowd loved it. Anyway, so Phil was like, no, I don't want this to be, anybody to be noticing that we're making a film. So that restricted a lot of what we could do.
Yeah.
You know, if you've seen all the Bon Jovi stuff with Wayne Isham on stage, you know, right there in his face with the camera. I mean, and they loved all that. No. So in those days, of course, we didn't have those tiny cameras you could put places, you know, so you could get a lot. There's a very famous shot once of a 16 mil camera strapped to the top of Mike Rutherford's guitar. Huh? And we were shooting down the guitar. That's and it was like so heavy, you know, I mean, and you couldn't play like that all night, obviously.
So you had mentioned that Japan was a little challenging for a variety of reasons. One of the things that was a problem, Phil was filmed sitting on the steps of one of the temples, and you said you had quite a difficult time with
that was Kyoto. I mean, Japan is a very structured society. I mean, and they have their customs, and like I don't know if you've ever been, but you know, taxi drivers wear white gloves. You're not allowed to tip, and they open your door for you with a special thing.
Oh wow!
You know, everybody is, you know, there's a certain thing. So our location person had to go to every location we would want and do a tea ceremony with these people and, you know, negotiate and all that stuff. So when we were in Kyoto, we just kind of said, oh, wait a minute, let's just have Phil sit on these steps and we'll do this. And unfortunately, we didn't have permission. And our location scout had to kind of like eat humble bread and do a lot of you know, peacemaking after that.
And then I never knew that the shot of Mount Fuji in the background was done on the bullet train. I didn't know that. That's fascinating to me. And why can't you film on the bullet train? What is their issue with you filming on?
They just said no. When we asked for permission. So we basically, you know, told our our Japanese mind is to go away, and then we shot it.
Yeah.
It's like one of those things where, you know, you think, well, why on earth couldn't they let you? You know, but I guess it's, they've got their rules and regulations, and we decided to break them, which is the American way, I guess.
For sure. I've always wanted to know the streetcar scene in San Francisco. Were the people on the streetcar just random people and you had Phil jump on, or was that actually where you had, you know, you stopped traffic and you had, you know?
No, it was completely on the fly. Phil went to one of the stops with our people, and we had walkie talkies, and they said, okay, we're getting on. And, you know, he got to the position. We did that twice. So we just had two goes at it.
Yeah, because
so went back again and got another tram.
It was different people. So the version that made the video, there's a lady that's sitting right where, you know, in the window, and then he'd be standing in front of her, and she just looks delighted. You know, and I thought, lucky lady she is, you know. It was cool. So that was just real. Did you position any of your people behind him so nobody could come up and, you know, do anything weird or?
No, but we had people there to stop interfering. Yeah.
What about, I always thought it was so silly, the shark in the pool. What was that? That was funny.
It was just, you know, it was a reference to Jaws.
Right. Yeah, it was good. I like that.
That house was actually belonged to a capital executive.
Oh, cool.
We knew from our PMI days.
Oh, neat. And so he said, come on over, and you guys shot there. Going back to Japan, the shots in the crosswalk with all the neon in Tokyo, it's my understanding that was what, right before or right after the show?
It was right after. For some reason, in Japan, they have these concerts that are real early. They start at 5 o'clock. And the people are so disciplined. I mean, they line up. It's almost like like schoolgirls, you know, they're all schoolboys. They're all lined up in crocodile lines, and they file in, and they do as they're told. And there are like traffic cops in all the aisles telling people to stay seated and not get up. And so they're very kind of disciplined. So we did what's called as a runner. As soon as Phil was done on stage, he came right up back, jumped into a car, and we went to where we wanted to shoot, which was that famous crosswalk with all the neon. And literally as we were shooting, the concert goers are coming to that part of the town. And they're like, wait a minute, we just saw this guy on stage. But nobody, because they're so disciplined, nobody interfered whatsoever. You know, nobody got in the way, tried to get an autograph, anything like that.
That's unbelievable.
But they are this. I haven't been to Japan since, but it was a very rigid society. So my wife was the production manager on the tour, and hence take me home. And we even made the mistake, I guess, of hiring a production company in Japan to do some of the stuff for us, and it was led by a woman. And so in every meeting, when you would be there and, you know, my wife, or she wasn't my wife then, Karen would ask a question, or the production person from Japan would, they would answer me. Mm. You know, I mean, they kind of like would ignore women.
Mm. It's hard. Mm. It must be difficult because it's very much not the culture that you or Karen came from, you know?
Yeah, and they were a bit, the Japanese promoter was a man called Mr. Udo, who is everything you think of the Yakuza, you know? You just think, this guy's Yakuza, you know? Not that he had a missing finger, but the whole aura of everything. And it was almost like a tug of war between us and them to get to have time with Phil. Mm-hmm. And we had arranged for Phil and Jill to stay in a ryokan, which is a traditional Japanese hotel. Mm-hmm. I mean, so it looks like exactly what you think from Shogun. It's got the tamitami screens, it's got geishas and mikos, the girls with a white face, in the robes, and everything. They had the baths, the really hot baths, and they'd give you massages, and you had this traditional meal in which there's entertainment. So we thought this would be great to have Phil and Jill there, and the Mr. Udo's men got to Jill and they said, "Jill, you won't like this. It's primitive. They don't even have hair dryers, you know." And so she was like, "Oh, we're not going to stay there." So Phil says, "You know, all right, well, we're not going to stay." So when they get there, and of course they see it's really nice, and we shot the whole dinner, which was funny. It was just, but the worst thing about this is you have a glass, right? You have a glass, and it's sake. You drink it, they fill it up again.
Oh no!
Don't drink it; it goes cold.
Ah.
So it's like, you know, I don't like drinking cold tea.
Right.
I don't like drinking cold sake. So you're on your way to oblivion pretty quickly. But it was funny. It was really funny. And then they left, and we had massages and steam baths and had fun.
See,
and when we told them about it the next day, they were kind of a bit pissed.
Well, yeah, he would have loved the steam bath because it would have been for his throat, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, no, it was fun. I mean, the music wasn't exactly to our taste, but, you know, it's Japanese traditional music with that kind of screeching, you know.
But what an experience, though, for sure.
Oh, yeah. And what else? Japan was a trip, you know. So was Australia. I mean, the film crews in Australia, which we went to before Japan, they were so great. And we lucked out that we hired Dean Semler as our DP. Now, Dean had shot Mad Max, you know, the Road Warrior.
Right.
You know, he went on to do Mad Max Thunder. He came over here after this and won an Oscar for Dances with Wolves.
Wow.
So he was our DP. And we had this small crew. And Dean was just brilliant. And the Australian, their work ethic and everything was just fantastic. I mean, we liked them so much that we took them to Japan.
Yeah.
And we even took his crew to America with us, two of them. Yeah. So Dean was great. I remember when they were filming the load-in at Budokan, and one of the assistant cameramen said, "Hey Dean, can we you know, go and get some breakfast?" And he said, "I didn't travel 8,000 miles to eat breakfast."
You just made me think of a question. One of the things that I know Budokan is, of course, Cheap Trick Live at Budokan, and you know, they scream throughout that whole show. The audiences are, you were just sort of alluding to it, that they're quite tame, you know, and they don't get up and they're not allowed to do that. How did Budokan achieve that? Is it because there it was an open seating? Why was there the screaming at the Cheap Trick shows? And I know it's not just Cheap Trick.
But... You to what me?
You seen Robin Zander?
Yeah.
I mean, they're sex symbols. Yeah, we did a lot for Cheap Trick, and they were one of my favorites to work. They were really great guys.
They're so. Graceland. Okay, the coolest scene, Phil standing at the gates, and of course they magically open. Tell me about working with Graceland. Were they easy to work with? Did they close down for you?
Jim couldn't be there, I forget why, but Jim had to drop off to do something. Mm-hmm. So I directed that little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, the people at Graceland were nothing but wonderful. But they wouldn't close it down.
Uh-huh.
They said the best we can do, because they had a bus go in every 2 minutes with tourists, a minibus, you know. So they said we can stop one bus. So that meant we, from when a bus went in, we essentially had 4 minutes to get it done.
And you did.
Yeah, we got it done. Yeah, and of course the inside joke was that the touring crew, the production crew, not the film crew, the touring crew, used to call Phil Little Elvis.
Elvis, I don't know, this guy doesn't know what his name is. Phil Collins, Bill Collins, Kenny Rogers, Elvis.
Hello.
Yes. Hello. Superintendent Strange. I was looking for Phil Collins, actually, or Bill Collins, or Elvis, whatever.
Yes.
So it was, which was, I think, unbeknownst to him for a long while.
Isn't that funny?
But then it eventually became so that he was even on his dressing room door, little Elvis.
Yeah. Yeah. Is Phil an Elvis fan?
Well, I don't know. I don't know if you've ever seen it, but we did a TV special called But Seriously.
Yes, yes.
And he plays Elvis in that.
Oh, if I stumble or if I fall, tell me back so I can make you see. Just give me one more night, one more night.
Jim, I don't feel very comfortable doing this, Jim. No, I'm not very happy with it, Jim.
Really? Doing the drum, yeah.
Doing the drum.
Yeah.
Very silly show. But I don't know if he was an Elvis fan. I don't think so. But, I mean, everybody's an Elvis fan to some degree.
Exactly. So some of my favorite parts of that video, of course, are the parts in London and then at his home, which I was finding that you actually shot at his actual home.
Yes, we did. I mean, he had a wonderful, huge, kind of old English, I wouldn't call it a stately home, but it was kind of a cross between a stately home and a mansion. But it was a really beautiful place. And obviously, we didn't want to, Phil doesn't like to be ostentatious anyway. So we only shot the back side kitchen of it.
Yeah.
And again, he doesn't want to be ostentatious. I mean, he didn't drive an ostentatious car anyway, but I think it was a BMW he used to drive. But so we got the Ford Poplar, yellow, which was a kind of an everyday car for in the 50s, I want to say, or the 60s. So it was a very unpretentious car for him. We shot at his house.
Yeah, it was cute. So there's a whole bunch of questions I have about this. You actually told a cute story in what you shared with me previously about Phil wanting to be with the kids. And so you said, we're going to send a helicopter, we'll make a day of it and the kids can go and so forth.
Yeah, when we finished the tour, we had some gaps in, where we'd marked to do something. So we basically said, look, we should, how about we come to London and we shoot these missing lines in London? And he was like, I got the kids and I don't want to. And we said, look, I mean, remember, this is all his money. So when we say we'll send a helicopter for you, what we mean is we'll send the helicopter, but the bill will go to you. So we said, look, we'll come over. We'll send a helicopter and then the kids can get to ride in the helicopter all the way up to London. It'll be great fun. Then we'll just zip around, get it done. You get in the helicopter, fly back. And he goes, oh, all right. So we plan it all and the locations. And the first one is Tower Bridge. And when they're at that, we did that because there's a helipad at Tower Bridge.
He
literally lands at Tower Bridge with his kids. Jolie and Simon, I want to say, and there he is, and he's in casual clothes like he was throughout in the video, but he's got this kind of sun hat on, which it's kind of a formless thing, and which is kind of quite fashionable now, but certainly then it kind of wasn't. And so he's wearing this hat and sunny. So we get in position, we check the framing and all that stuff. So all right. So I say, all right, Steve. And I say, okay, Phil, can you lose the hat now? And he goes, I didn't wash my hair. I said, we flew 8,000 miles to be here. We sent a helicopter to your house to pick you up, to bring you here, and you can't wash your fucking hair? he just laughed. Just laughed and, all right, took it off, and then he put it back on for the rest of them. So rest of the London shoot.
You know that immediately after I got that information from you, I immediately went to the video because I wanted to see if his hair looked funky. It didn't. His hair looked fine. It looked like it looked every other time I've ever seen him, you know.
Yeah. No, that some people are lucky. I can't actually go out without washing my hair. My hair, it looks like when I wake up, it looks like Methuselah, all the snakes. That's when the curls come back. Curls come back at night.
That's fantastic. You know, you had mentioned that he was quite casual, all the clothes, you know, in that video, which he was. I was going to ask you, the hat and then, you know, the shirt he was wearing, none of that was wardrobe planned. It's just what he turned up in that day.
Yeah. I mean, we probably should have planned better, you know, we probably should have taken Polaroids at each one, said, look, you've done this, you've done, you know, don't wear the same outfit. That's completely down to us.
Yeah, no.
He wore the same shirt on
Live Aid. He did, yeah, which was cool. I thought it was cool. And the London shoot that you did, I was hoping that you were going to tell me that, no, it was just what he turned up in, because the shirt's this sort of wrinkled thing that, you know, the buttons are not quite, and they're quite, you know, sort of open, and the he just looked like he rolled out of bed, which I think is more charming, to be honest, especially for what he was doing, you know, just driving in the old car, you know, Sunday afternoon out. I thought it was really, really something. So I'm actually quite pleased that it was just what he turned up in. He's funny because, you know, he acknowledges he's not quite the fashion plate. I heard him being interviewed about when they recorded the Band-Aid song, you know, prior to Live Aid.
And of course, Phil Collins looked like the plumber who just turned up from around the corner.
So we don't sing the
It wasn't my most fashionable moment. I was obviously going through some fashion problems at that point in my life. And what I remember, well, I know it's a brown kind of, you know, kind of, I don't know, Fair Isle, is it? A brown Fair Isle sleeveless jumper with something underneath. Probably a shirt that doesn't go quite with it. And maybe sweatpants. This was, I obviously didn't know there was going to be film crews there. Otherwise, I'd have worn the red Fair Isle. No, I wasn't Mr. Fashion at all then.
Not a fashion plate, but anyway, charming, nevertheless.
He became one during the chapter required. I mean, he had Armani suits and, you know, the T-shirt he had cost like $150 for a T-shirt.
Yeah.
He and Eric Clapton were kind of going, you know, fashion designer to fashion designer.
Yeah, no, he did. The Sirius tour was, right? I think that was that time period.
Yeah,
for sure. So when you guys did the shot of him driving off to start his journey, did you take that overhead of the car from the helicopter?
That wasn't him. No, that was done separately. And his wife, Jill, liked the car, so he said Phil liked the car so much she bought it for him after the shoot.
The actual car from the video.
Yeah.
That is so cool. The other thing I was going to ask you about, the roundabout scene at the Buckingham Palace, did you guys have to have permits back then, or did you just kind of roll up, do it, and then, you know, leave?
I don't think we did it without permits. I doubt it. But yeah, you know, because we were such a small crew, uh-huh, it wasn't like you would, you know, it wasn't like you had five trucks and a, you know, honey wagon and all that stuff. It was just basically, you know, one van with us.
Mm-hmm. Equipment. Jump out,
get the shot, jump back in. But I don't know if we had the permits, but I can't imagine that we wouldn't have, because, you know, I think at that time we were still under the umbrella of PMI.
Yeah. And in that scene, the car, you know, is coming around and then it sort of pulls out of the roundabout. But then there's a family that walks past. And I thought, are those extras, or is that just a real family that happened to show up and be in the video?
No, we didn't have any extras in those shoots.
So it's just real people just walking by. That's so cool. My question about his wardrobe included that I thought it looked like it was his floor drobe. That's the thing that we ladies say about men who turn up and
pick it up off the floor.
The floor drove. We're going back to when you were starting to go on that 85 tour, but the film crew actually got to travel and stay with the musicians, meaning that you got to go on the plane and you stayed at the fancier hotel and so forth. And that sometimes the crew was a bit bothered, but over time, especially on multiple tours, there was a lot of the same people. Tell me a little bit about that. And if you want to tell me the FFC story, I think it's really funny.
Well, inevitably, you know, these people work really hard, road crews.
Yeah.
And, you know, when the show is done, you go, great, ooh, that's over with. No, it's not. You know, they've got 3-4 hours worth of work to get all that stuff down into the trucks, you know, before that. And then they've got to sleep on the bus on the way to the next gig. And then they got to get up and build it all up again. So much as they obviously they love that life, when they see us, the film crew, flying on the private plane, staying at the Four Seasons hotels, it's not hard to have a low opinion of those people. So yes, we were the fucking film crew, because we were privileged, but you know, and they were. They're a tough lot, but they'd all worked together for many, many years. And so they were a family. And ultimately, you know, they came to know that, look, this is something that their boss wants. It's not like we've said, hey, we're coming with you. Is that okay? It's like, I'm hiring these people. They need to be in these things because of the things they're doing. So eventually it kind of softened, and as we went around the tour, and the more that we would film them, the more it would break down that, because they loved, you know, playing up to the camera. They, you know, they all had a good time. And then especially on the tour, when, you know, obviously it's all, you know, you're traveling from place to place, but you do get days off, and on the days off, usually the promoters will arrange something. Sometimes, you know, sometimes it's a barbecue, sometimes a softball game, sometimes it's, you know, we're going to, in Houston, we go to Six Flags, you know? So we would film everybody going on the rides at Six Flags. And
so fun.
And then one time, when Michelob came on board as the sponsor, tour sponsor, they had to add St. Louis as a date, you know, so that, and it was basically, I don't want to say it's bought out by Michelob, but I think most of their employees were there. And Michelob threw open the gift shop. They gave us a tour of Anheuser-Busch. Uh-huh. And then they threw open the gift shop and said,
have at it.
Have at it. Take whatever you want. And so, of course, the crews, you know, swag.
Yeah.
And Phil that saw this Budweiser can that was a fridge. It was a Budweiser, a huge Budweiser can that was a fridge. And he said, I'll have that. You know, send that to my house in England.
And did he really have it?
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
That's hysterical.
I mean, obviously it wasn't in their kitchen. It was in his boys' room, wherever that was.
Right. That's really funny. That's a cute, I love that. That's a cute little story. We actually had to do a piece
for a Michelob convention or Anheuser-Busch with Phil months later. Uh-huh. And out of his bed, he's going on and he's saying, you know, the usual, whatever he's got to say. And he goes, by the way, where's my fridge?
They hadn't sent it yet.
But he eventually did.
That's great. Did you, the last question I have, and we'll move on from Take Me Home, is I never ever knew it, and it's funny how your brain just hears what it wants to hear. At the end of the video, he returns home and you hear a character playing his wife that's asking, you know, and I heard it as a British accent.
Well, darling, I'm home. I've been to Tokyo, Sydney, New York, London.
You've been down at the pub, haven't you?
Now that I know who it is, I know that person doesn't have a British accent. So I listened again, watched it again. I thought, there's not really, I mean, you know, there's a tiny bit of the phrasing that's a little more British than American. But tell our listening and video audience who it is that at the end, who is that woman playing his wife?
Well, the voice was, in fact, his wife, Jill Collins.
Mm-hmm. Well, darling, I'm home. Oh, I've been to Tokyo, Sydney, New York, London.
You've been down at the pub, haven't you?
I would think that just by hanging around with a lot of English people, you tend to, like, I know, I don't even know if you know I'm English, but
yes.
When I go back to England, people will say to me, oh, you don't all sound like a Yankser. And I was like, what?
Right.
And I think that because of certain, you know, phrasings and certain words like that we say slightly different, like, you know, we say controversy and controversy, you know what I mean? It's like weird things like that. And I think just by hanging around English people, you pick up that stuff. And I think Jill probably just picked up.
So yes, she probably did. Yeah, but I never knew it was her. We're moving on to Don't Lose My Number, which you guys shot in Australia. And that's where you brought, I think Dean Semler, is that where you met him?
Yes. Yeah. We actually knew we had to shoot this video in Australia, but we didn't have any ideas. But we knew we were on tour. So what it meant was we had very limited time. I mean, you know, we maybe got a day off here, a day off there with them. But, you know, often on a day off, they don't all want to be doing a video all day, right? So it would be, we need to come up with some stuff that we can shoot a little in little bits.
Mm-hmm.
And we used to have a joke. So Jim and I remember this as we had breakfast in the hotel restaurant. But he remembers this as being poolside. I went with poolside in my notes. And I brought up that we used to have this joke about directors pitching their ideas in the manner of their style. Yeah, so like there was a guy called Martin Kahane who used to direct, and he his videos were always smoked up. So he would come in the room with smokers, you know, those horrible, and then, you know, Bob Giraldi, who was known for dance, would come in with all these dancers going around and all that kind of stuff. So that's we thought, well, why don't we do that? We'll do. And it's a great thing. It's like, and this is another one. It's kind of a trope of ours, but it's not necessarily a video trope. But it's like it's having your cake and eat it. Mm. So a director would come in and say, Phil, here's what I see. And then we would see a bit of that. And then you cut back and Phil goes, nah, that's not really me. You know, I don't see myself as a cowboy. But he's already been the cowboy.
Right.
So he gets to do it and then say, you know, don't criticize me for being a cowboy. It wasn't my idea. Right. So the whole idea of Don't Lose My Number was all these different directors coming in and pitching him everything from Mad Max to Every Breath You Take and Bob Giraldi and so on, you know. So, and having Dean Semler, Dean told us this funny thing. He said, we shot Mad Max or in Road Warrior. We went to the spot of Australia where it like hadn't rained for 60 years. And then it rained for like 30 days, day and night. So, you know, Dean said, so we had to shoot a lot of Mad Max indoors. He basically, when we had to shoot that Mad Max thing, which is by far and away the most, and that everybody enjoyed. We got some of the road crew were dressed up. You know, the band was dressed up. They loved it.
Oh yeah,
they loved it. Phil, I got to tell you that Peter Robinson.
Oh yeah.
Looked like the guy with the helicopter.
Yeah.
I mean, he looked exactly like him.
Yeah, he did. Yes.
You know, and Phil with the mohawk.
Yeah, they look cool.
They love dressing up. They really do love to sing. So so we came up with this idea of all the different things, and so we shot all the bit with the directors pitching it, and they were just like extras, except Peter Robinson was the first director, wearing the red shoes, and that was modeled after director Julian Temple, who did all Sex Pistols stuff, and he did some of the Rolling Stones. He did the Bowie film, Absolute Beginners.
Yeah.
Oh. And he came to my house in LA, and he was dressed just like that. I mean, it was like, not even on your day off, you know? So I dressed him up as Julian Temple. And again, coming from the Monty Python camp, the fact that they just talk in film titles.
Shane. Once upon a time in the West.
The Alamo?
The 310 to Yuma.
The Wild Bunch.
The man who shot Liberty Valance.
Fistful of Dollars.
The good, the bad, and the ugly.
It's like that shorthand of, you know, this is what I imagine. Well, I imagine this. How about that? No, how about this? You know, and then of course it switches from Western titles to Western stars.
Ah, Clint Eastwood.
Gary Cooper.
John Wayne.
Henry Fonda.
Burt Lancaster.
Kirk Douglas.
Robert Redford.
Newman.
Steve McQueen. Mal Craigs.
And it was like, well, how do we end this? And I forget whose idea it was, but probably Peter and Phil's. But they came up with Mal Craigs.
Mal Craigs.
Who was the tour manager. And then we cut in the video directly to Mal Craigs walking down the street with a girl on each arm, which is how Mal Craigs would like to see himself in life.
He's a good looking dude.
Because he is. And dude. he was the one who played Mad Max.
Yeah, he was cute.
So it goes into the Western, is the first one. And so we found this Western town outside of Sydney. And luckily, I mean, like Leland and Peter and Tony Smith, I mean, they look the part. Leland with his big beard, Tony Smith's beard, you know? And the guy who plays the Gary Cooper type sheriff is Morris Leiter, who was the tour production manager. And he came from Texas. And he was like, he is like one of the most laconic people you could ever meet. And I mean, really, he was just a delight always to be with. And he was probably the only person on the set who could shoot a gun, right? Yeah. So he plays the sheriff, and Phil and his guys come into town. Now, we wanted to have this big moon. And so Dean told us that when he was doing Razorback, they had planned on a moonshot, but there was clouds. So what they did was they got a huge piece of film core, you know, which is that kind of styrofoam, and they cut a huge moon out of it, and then they hung it somewhere, and then they put a spotlight on it, and that became the moon. On Razorback, they went so late that the moon, second moon, came up. The real moon was in the shot with the moon. We didn't have that problem, but we had, that was our moon, was that's the styrofoam. And so we did that cowboy, and then we did the Mad Max was a hoot. We shot that outside of Perth. And as I say, they all loved getting dressed up as Mad Max. And if you look at that bit of the video, there is actually only one shot where anything moves. And that's because Dean Semler showed us how to do all this stuff without them actually moving, because they were stuck in this you know, structure for 30 days and 30 nights.
Right.
The rain. So only one shot in that sequence is a moving shot. So we got a dog, the Blue Gila, and Mal Craggs was the played Mad Max.
Yeah.
Bill played the guy with the mohawk, and yeah, it was a really fun thing. One of the funny things was when we were doing the director's thing, we wanted to have a kind of, dare I say, this Yoko Ono type director who would come in, and we would do a samurai shoot. And so we're waiting, and this woman has not come. She's not come. So my wife is half Indian and half Finnish. So she's kind of this exotic, almost Asian looking. So we had to put her in makeup with and the hair. And just as she'd finished being made up, the actress walks in. That didn't go down so well. So then the actress, we find out, can't speak English. So we had to think, well, how do we do? And then it kind of dawned on me that how absurd would it be to have her, as the song is playing, she's telling Phil the action, which is just the lyrics, but she's saying them in Japanese. And the translator is translating them into English for Phil, who actually wrote them, so he knows what they're saying. So you're hearing the music, and then you're hearing this Japanese woman saying it in Japanese. They came at night, right? And then it put in Japanese. And then the translator is saying they came at night. It's like, it was just absurd.
Isn't it? Shadows are on the ground. Nobody knew where to find him. No evidence was found.
So that was funny. And then Phil, when you have to do that samurai thing, his hairline was perfect.
Yeah. He looks good. I thought it was fantastic. That video is it's so much fun. I love the bits where you, the Bob Giraldi stuff, where all the dancers, how you shot Phil, you know, kind of the quick takes of his various expressions. And he's so expressive. And, you know, he really is a good actor. He really is. He could have been perhaps an actor if he wanted to have been. You know, what was fun, and I meant to ask you, is I'm sure that people listening know this, but if they don't, Phil is an avid collector of Alamo memorabilia and loves all of that. And of course donated a tremendous collection to the Alamo itself. But in the beginning with the director, where they're saying the names of the films, Phil says Alamo.
I'm in the West. The Alamo?
Did he want to do it because he loves the Alamo, or did you guys write it, or how did that go?
Well, I wrote it. And I don't think I knew then.
Oh, wow.
He had this Alamo thing, but I found out I knew that between that video and Don't Let It Rain Down, where we used him as Davy Crockett in that. So that's why I knew it by then, but I don't think I knew it when I wrote that.
Oh, that's so cool. It's fortuitous for sure. You know what? The part of that,
that's what started his interest.
Perhaps it was. You did it. You did. That's cool. I know. The sandwich eating guy was so gross. Was he actually based on a real person? And Phil was so grossed out by him. he's either a really good actor, or that guy's just gross.
Well, again, this was one of Jim's reoccurring motifs, right? He seemed to have some kind of, always had a thing for heavy set people, for overweight people. And he wanted, so the idea was of this was that, and we were, you know, a lot of this was being made up as we went along. So when the actual props arrived, there was a fort and there was these things, and they obviously didn't match. You know, it was kind of like, are you nuts? So, you know, to the prop department, what are you doing? And so we had to write the line, this is not to scale.
So what happens in the guitar solo?
Okay, well, by now we're outside the fort. This is not to scale, of course.
Right? Because it obviously wasn't.
Right.
And the idea that we wanted, and I honestly, I've had more people quote this line to me than anything when he goes, he says, are you going to eat that sandwich? Which is, you know, to make the guy appear gluttonous.
You going to eat that sandwich?
No, go ahead.
Who's playing
the... And this is all through Daryl Sturmer's guitar solo.
Right.
And he says, who's playing the guitar? And so Phil says, Daryl Sturmer. And the guy says, great. And you think he's talking about Daryl's guitar, but he follows up with, great sandwich.
Who's playing the guitar?
Daryl Sturmer.
Great. Great sandwich. So you ride right through the front gate.
And I get that thrown at me a lot. People who like these things. And we actually used that again in another video, Jeff Beck video for Ambitious. We used like a lookalike and sandwich and that in there.
It's hysterical.
So no, we didn't know who that guy was. It was just somebody cast and, you know, and then, you know, you're at the beach, you know, which is like trying to save, you know, like this isn't working, the night thing. All right, you're at the beach.
Now we have a bunch of beautiful ladies. So were those all extras, those ladies?
Yeah.
They were extras.
Jill was not among them.
Yeah, I had read that she was, and I didn't see her in the lineup. So,
and it was an overcast day, sadly, on the beach. I think it was Bondi Beach that we did that at.
Uh-huh. That's that famous where they have the big surf, right?
Yeah, no, it was a very overcast day. But that was, yes, that was a poke at Elton John.
Yeah, well, it was really a cute part. He did a nice job, but he sort of imitated that really well and danced and all that. You know, it was cute. It was a cute, you know, it's a really a nice video. I liked it a lot. The end is really funny. Where he's the fly from the Cars, you might think video. And tell me a little bit about the idea behind the clapboard and not having an ending.
Well, Jim wanted to, it's, you know, because that's obviously a question that comes up a lot. How does it end?
Yeah.
So, and so we thought, Jim thought, why don't we just keep repeating it? So when he does that,
yeah,
you know, he would, and then the same thing again. And he would put on, he wanted to do this for like 40 minutes.
And Jim would have broadcast it that way just to see what he could get away with.
Jim doesn't get to broadcast these things.
Right. So,
no, people would not have shown it. So I said to him, look, people are not going to do it for 45 minutes, but they may do it. They may do it for two or three.
Right. Which is how you shot it. I think three, right?
So how does it end? So how does it end?
Our editor, David Foster, did that that little thing with the fly.
Yeah.
We did that in the edit bay.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was just a few frame thing and brilliant. I mean, again, this was done when? In the 80s? So this is like way before there was a lot of easier ways to do it.
Yeah, that was cool. I was actually, that's another video I just watched. And I thought, you know, Phil's face on the fly, he looked really quite concerned. And I thought, it's funny. It just was funny. It was cute.
I mean, the thing is, Phil does bring it to the plate when he's on camera and these things. Yeah, he really does.
He's great. He's so fun. You know, you had mentioned the concept for the video. Jim remembers it being poolside. And in something that you had shared with me, you said that hotel that you were, it was quite known for rock stars staying there, and that you actually saw Queen and Fleetwood Mac at that hotel.
Like, yeah, it was the Sunset Marquee of Sydney.
That's so cool. And had you met the guys in Queen previously?
I had worked with Fleetwood Mac before,
mm-hmm.
But not Queen.
Wow. And so Freddie was there and you saw him in real life?
Didn't see Freddie. Saw a Brian.
So. Uh-huh. Yeah, he's a cool guy.
He is great.
When they did the tour with Paul Rogers, which was fantastic. I love Paul Rogers. I went to the Hollywood Bowl, I think is where it was. And they did a, I don't know, some meet and greet, and I got to briefly say, you know, so I feel like I had a brush with greatness. Brian May is pretty mega, you know, pretty neat. He was very nice too. Very nice gentleman, you know, friendly.
Yes. Yes. No, I mean, absolutely. When we did them for Rock Honors, it was great. I told it's not really relevant, but both my sons have autism, and one of them wouldn't learn to read until he heard We Will Rock You. And then he wanted to learn how to sing We Will Rock You. And that was the thing that got him over the hump. And I told this to Brian, and Brian said, well, bring him to the show. So I did, and he met Brian May, and you know, had kids, and you know, you think that would be enough, but no, my kid says, I want to play the drums. I say, you don't play the drums. They already have a drummer.
Did Roger Taylor get him up with a kid?
No. But you know, it was really, really so nice of Brian to pay him that kind of attention. It was a great memory.
One of my favorite Brian May memories of Golden Jubilee, when he's standing atop of Buckingham Palace doing God Save the Queen. That's for me, I don't know if history will look back on moments in music and revere it as I do, but I just think it was one of the neatest moments in music, and also, you know, the Queen and so forth. And I went to Jubilee this year. I was hoping that Brian May would have done a repeat performance, but he didn't, you know.
Well, why spoil it? Why do it again, you know?
Right.
It dilutes the moment.
Right. You're right. You see, that's why you're in charge of things like broadcasting those kinds of things, right? Yeah. Don't lose my number. Do we miss any good stories?
No, I think that the big ones were, you know, the Mad Max and the cowboy, right?
Yeah, well, and I think, you know, I meant to say this before, but the fact that you had the guy who actually did the real Mad Max actually doing your shoot, I mean, it's so cool. And that's probably why it looked so realistic. I mean, it was really well done.
Yeah, no, we were very lucky. We took hot shots at the police also in that. And, yeah. You know, Phil said, well, what's Sting going to say? You know,
he's not going to care, right? I mean, it's sort of homage-esque, yeah. Right? I mean, they're... weren't unkind. Yeah. So this is a part I want to chat about. There's a couple live things that I love, and I don't think that you had anything to do with the Perkins Palace production in 82/83. I'm not quite sure. That's one of my favorite live Phil Collins shows. That the Dallas show, the Reunion Arena show, that May 29th show, and you guys filmed in 85, that ultimately became the HBO special and then No Ticket Required. I just think it captures Phil and the guys, you know, the Phoenix Horns were so cool. I mean, they were doing percussion and backing vocals. And it was just, I think it's a moment in time that you captured. Phil, I don't know because he knew you were filming, if he was turning it on, but I felt very much connected, and I thought it was really an emotional show. And I just loved it so much. And I wanted to just ask a little bit about that show in terms of documentary footage. So when we had corresponded, you actually shot the May 29th show, not only for the concert portion, but you also shot some stuff for the documentary, which then never came out. Is that right? Or am I just misunderstanding?
Well, I think you misunderstood. There was the documentary was a completely separate thing.
Mm-hmm.
We were doing the documentary from here to here, that the, you know, from the beginning to the end.
Right.
But not all of it. We would just do spots here and there. Then on the way, we were always shooting Take Me Home.
Yeah.
We had to shoot in Australia. We had to shoot Don't Lose My Number. And then in America, we had to shoot this concert. So, you know, we just like just switched kind of horses for a moment. So we had to abandon the documentary for a second while we shot the Dallas concert.
Got it.
Obviously much more crew, cameras, equipment, et cetera.
So was that the show where he had said, I want it to be a concert film and not a...
Yeah.
That was that show. A film gig. How did you guys then do it with that restriction that Phil's placing on you? Did you just more wide shots or standing behind things or...
No, I mean, longer lenses,
mm-hmm.
And just, it just meant we couldn't go on the stage.
Uh-huh.
We could, he didn't want us to, like, you know, light up the audience and, like, right. Sometimes those kind of things happen, you know?
Yeah.
He just didn't want people to think it was, that they were being used as part of the audience for a film gig. And I think we managed that. It wasn't like, I don't think it was like the best concert we've ever shot, but it still won awards, you know. And I think you asked me, did Phil get up for film gigs? I don't think so. I don't think it's any different, because I think he has a loyalty to the audience every time he steps on that stage. And it's the same whether there's film cameras there or not. And I've done many concerts with him alone. I've done many concerts with him as part of Genesis.
Mm-hmm.
I've never seen, you know, any wavering in his commitment in any of these shows. Even when we would see shows we'd be watching for making notes, you know. And I don't think he was affected by that at all.
Yeah, Leland, I asked him what was one of the, you know, best things that he could say about Phil or something. And he said that he was so impressed, and it's not the case with, and Leland's played with many, many, many people. Show one, night one, is going to be the same quality of show as show 5 or 10 for the audience. Phil was so committed to making sure that every one of his audiences got the very best of him and everything. And that was Leland's compliment. And I thought it was a fantastic compliment. And then I have heard that has been a recurring theme, that his dedication to the fans, you know, also depending on what part of the world he was in, he would say, oh no, they didn't like that song here. Let's do this. Always wanting to make sure that the fans had the best experience. And I think my question was he turning it on when you guys were being filmed wasn't necessarily that it was false, but rather that he got into another gear because he knew that many more people would be watching. And so then it was just more of an emotional drive for him. For example, the song Take Me Home, that live from Dallas, it's just so spectacular. I don't know if you've seen it recently, but if you haven't, it's just, I love it. Job capturing him.
I don't think he does see it as different. I think his loyalty, as I say, is to the audience, and he wants to give them the best possible show. But I don't think you see him playing to the camera.
No.
You don't see him mugging to a camera.
No.
He doesn't acknowledge them, you know?
No, and I think I actually had a question earlier that I skipped. When you're filming the band, how long does it take if you have someone that's perhaps new on the tour? How does that go when you're filming people that aren't used to it?
Well, I think always the very beginning is always a, you know, here's a camera stuck in your face, here's a camera shooting you when you wouldn't normally have a camera shooting you. So you've always got that awkwardness. But, you know, eventually, especially like, you know, and on a world tour, it just becomes part of the scenery. You expect it. I mean, one of the things that Phil would do was as he's coming out, I'd go, "Hi, Doug," you know, to the cameraman. And we say, "To the camera, hi, Doug." Yeah, here we are again. It's like, but yes, but no, it just melts away and it becomes, you know, second nature.
Part of the job.
Yeah. I mean, people who mug the camera and all that stuff, you know, they're the people, it's kind of the newbies, if you will, you know?
Yeah.
Although the Stones do it like to this day.
Mug to the camera.
Ron Wood is the biggest mug to the camera I think I've ever seen.
Oh, that's great. That's great. I love it.
You know, I mean, yeah. The only thing was that when we did Groovy Kind of Love, we just couldn't find the right location. And we ended up in that industrial place because I was looking for a stately mansion with, you know, like a library with books everywhere and very ornate. And my location people in England couldn't come up with it. And I still don't believe it to this day that they couldn't find it. So we ended up going, you know, 180 degrees opposite and going for that industrial thing.
Yeah, it had a very film noir feel to me, or sort of a dark feeling. And it just was, I thought it was an unusual video. It had a different energy than I was used to, you know, with Phil videos. And so I thought, was that done on purpose or?
Yeah, well, he made the song very melancholy. And the idea is, obviously, here's a person in that, is he in prison? Is he in a kind of a high security prison? Right. And he's being allowed to watch scenes from his life to kind of show this is what you're missing, you know. You know. Yeah.
So that was the intent then behind it. That was sort of the.
It was kind of a, you know, a loose subtext for Two Hearts.
Yeah.
Two Hearts. We, you know, Phil liked the fact that he'd played different instruments in some of his videos.
Yeah.
So he'd been all the things. So he wanted to do that again. So we did that. And we got we made it this TV show. And it was supposed to be a joke, the four pennies, because I forget what it is now.
Pound note.
Remember, in England, we have a £5 note, right? Like you have a $5 here.
Right.
So the idea was, well, we'll wear the £5 notes, but one of the guys left. So now with the four,
and the guys,
doesn't make sense. You know, it doesn't make sense.
Girls, we're very lucky because we have from the £4 notes, Phil Collins. Phil, an unusual name for the group, I think.
Yeah, well, there used to be five of us, Tony.
Really?
Yeah.
That's a fascinating story, Phil. I expect you'll want to join the lads right now, won't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, lovely. Well, indeed, right now, here is Phil and, of course, the £4 notes and their latest record, which I know is going to do very well. You're going to love it. It's called Two Hearts.
And the guy was Tony Blackburn, who was huge, huge DJ one time. Started out on pirate radio and then became fixture at the BBC. And he, you know, he graciously came along and did it because he was in his that time period of his. And that was so complicated. I actually remember sending Tony Smith a list, which was literally a page long, of the technical things that we had to do to make that happen. Wow. You know, because it was transfer from film to tape and tape film of the tape. And it was just like, just to get all that stuff. It was, you know, because he's looking at a moviola, he's got a TV there. That, you know, it's like all that stuff. It was very complicated, but deceptively so.
Yeah, well, and the continuity with him playing all the same characters but different clothing, I'm sure was somewhat difficult too.
No, not really. No, I mean, I don't remember that.
It wasn't.
You know, we just had to shoot him in, you know, different positions and to get it all. And there was one, you know, there was just one shot where you see the two of them in the same shot and it crosses over. And we achieved that by using a mobile blue screen, you know, green screen, you know, that is right. So that would be, we use that so that we could key in the other image across him.
Oh, that's neat.
To make it look like, oh, how did they do that?
Yeah.
How did the two of them cross each other in the same picture?
Well, that's really cool. I think we should jump quickly to a spectacular video that you won some awards for, and Rain Down, you know, with you had Eric Clapton and Jeffrey Tambor, and I think Lamont Dozier was in there as well, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was. Yeah, he was.
Yeah.
This was, I think, at the end of the tour, when we, you know, at the Phil, we were having a big party at the end, and Phil dragged Jim and I to us away, and he said, "I really want to tell you guys how much I appreciate, you know, what you do for me, and I want you to keep your best ideas for my next album." So we said, "No problem, no problem." So I remember this vividly. We were in an edit bay, and there's a phone call. It says, "Phil Collins for you." So Jim and I were there, and I put it on speaker, and we say, "Phil." He says, "I've got a new album." We said, "Great, we have got some great ideas." And he goes, "Yeah." I said, "You know, we said these are some of them are so funny, you'll love it." And he goes, "Well, this album's a bit serious. In fact, I've called it But Seriously." And I said, "Wait a minute. You ask us to keep our best ideas, our funniest ideas for you for 3 years, and then you come out with a serious fucking album?" You know, and he goes, "Well, you know, look, send me the ideas, and, you know, maybe some of them will work." So we had compiled about 20 ideas and we sent them to him. And, you know, some of them, as I told you earlier, some of them were concepts that we'd actually had for other people, but they didn't want to do them. So we kept them. They were our ideas. So we gave them to Phil. And one of those was Don't Let It Rain Down, which originally was done for Elton John, because Jim and I had done a kind of a promotional video for the Tropicana Hotel in Vegas. At that time, they had this campaign, which was very stylized. And it was like, "Come to the island." And it was all stuff that was shot, like a guy floating in a tank, you know, with a parrot. And all everything was not the hotel. So the travel agents would say to the hotel, "Well, what's the hotel look like? We don't even know." So they said, "We need to do this video to show people what a hotel looks like." So we were to do this. And one of the things when we were there was they had a show called Folie Bergère, which was their topless thing. Not all topless, but certain parts of it were topless. The best parts, right? So, and I was just amazed at how fast they could change sets, because it was all flown, you know, and it was all this stuff. So it got me thinking. And so I came up with this concept for Elton John, which was essentially the same one that we pitched to Phil, which is that the singer doesn't show up in a rehearsal. And so they grab the pianist guy and put him up there, and he starts singing. And then you see his whole career path to success. And at the very end, you collapse it, and it was all in his head.
Yeah.
So he picked that for that song. And it was a lot of fun. And Eric Clapton was in it. And Jeffrey Tambor was somebody we'd used in a lot of stuff. He was a good friend of ours. Yeah. And it was an interesting shoot.
I think it's a great video. It's really fun. And I think, you know, it's Eric's great when he says, a guy who used to play drums in a really good band, you know, and when the singer left, he took over. I was fantastic writing. You guys really did a nice job with it. It's really good.
The most important number in the show.
Can't someone else sing it?
What about Billy? He's got a good voice.
Who is this?
He used to be the drummer in a really good band, and when the singer left, he took over.
Let me ask you a question. How good can he be if he's back playing drums again?
Well, it's only the one song. What do we got to lose? You might as well give him a shot.
That's good. That's good. Wait, wait. If he's going to sing, who's going to play the drums?
What about Chester?
Who is that?
Okay. Okay. Just get on with it.
I swear I don't believe I'd see you in these parts again, Mr. Beauregard.
Well, y'all know this war has changed many a man's anticipations, ma'am.
Terrible. Thought you said you could act.
I never said I could act. He said I could sing.
All right, play the song.
Yeah, I mean, it was like, there was a lot of like Easter eggs, as you say, in those, like the, we had him as Davy Crockett, which was a nod to his Alamo thing. And we got these lookalikes in, like the Humphrey Bogart lookalike and a Clark Gable lookalike.
It was
a lot of fun.
It was cute. And you foreshadowed his winning the Oscar too. Although it wasn't Clark Gable, it was Cher, but.
Isn't that good?
That was a good
it was a real fun video to make. That was great.
Yeah, it was.
I'm a big fan of those movies. And then especially when you see the map of the United States and the train going across it with the map, you know, I love all that stuff.
They did that in Indiana Jones.
Exactly. And
that was neat.
Yeah, you know, and how it's done is that you put a strip where you want it, and then you put the light behind it.
Oh, cool.
It lights through.
Oh, that's neat.
Which I didn't know until our DP showed us. It was great. We shot that at the Belasco in downtown LA, which is a really old theater that was disused at the time. And yeah, we got Chester in there and Leland's in there, I think, isn't he?
In the Do You Remember video, which was a cute concept. I just was going to ask you, what's the situation with the root beer float reference? Was it just a funny sort of thing, or root beer floats?
It was to avoid getting into trouble for saying Coke or Pepsi.
What'd you think? Good. Come on in. Your root beer floats here, and there's a phone call for you.
There's Splinter, all that stuff. You know, those kind of things bring you down. With the censors, you know, the big business people at all the networks, you know, why should we give Coca-Cola a free ad? Why should we give Pepsi a free ad?
Okay, so there was no hidden meaning behind it.
No, it was just to be a generic drink that sounded American.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. It's very American. You're right. Moving on quickly to Something Happened on the Way to Heaven. That was fun. The idea behind that being you see life through the dog's eyes. So
We'd had that for a long time, that idea. We shot that down at where they used to shoot all the old British horror films, Hammer Studios. And that's where Phil and the band were doing their rehearsals. So yeah, we found this dog, which was actually apparently a descendant of Benji, like a third level, whatever. And so we opened with this silent movie, you know, with the Benji dog untying the woman who's tied to the tracks. And then we find out that's just his dream, right? Another music video trope. And then he goes running in and it's, you're right. So as you say, it's through his eyes, a lot of it. We see what's going on. And we just always wanted to do that. And Phil agreed to do it. And I think it worked out really well. It was difficult because the dog being trained, it wouldn't do the things that we wanted, like jump up on the food table and eat from the food table. You know, the trainer would say, he's trained not to do this. He's trained not to do this. So we had to work around that. And then the playing the instruments, that we actually had to make a pause made so we could play the piano.
That's cute.
That was, I think, Jim playing the piano with that. The peeing on Lee. Benji was actually a female. So we actually had to have nylon thread rigged up to lift the leg and a squirter to do the pee. Wouldn't you know it, right? You cast a dog that's a female.
That's
pee on somebody.
That's great. That is so cute. Leland was such a good sport to be peed on, but a little that I know it wasn't real.
You must have known Leland is a player. He just loves all this stuff. He loves getting into it, and he'll do, you know, he'll pretty much play along with anything you want.
Yeah, he's and, great.
He's great.
He's a lovely person. So there's two more quick videos before we get into a couple of quick questions, then we'll finish. I wanted to just jump to the everyday video. I for whatever reason, I think it has such a beautiful, it was shot so beautifully. And I think, I know that we talked about Phil not being a matinee idol, you know, in his mind. I think he looks so handsome in that video. And it's just a really, really nice video. I always thought, oh, how sad, you know, he's being left, right? Until I read what you wrote me. And there's a surprise ending that I never knew. I never caught it. I don't know, I'm not very observant. Tell me about the surprise ending and how you guys thought it up and what happens.
The look of that was down to our DP, Tony Mitchell, who did a lot of our stuff in New York. He's brilliant, brilliant DP. The idea was that you think that he's been left, but at the very, and that you always think when you see the woman coming and arriving that they're somehow going to reconnect. But so the idea that switcheroo at the end was that the bait and switch was that actually he's the one leaving, and they pass in the elevators, as it were, so they don't actually meet.
Yeah, and you realize he's left her.
Yeah,
which was great. That was really good. Yeah, that was a beautiful. I just love that video. The album Testify, Wake Up Call. For me, it's one of my favorite later Phil songs, and I think it was kind of, it missed its time in the sun, and I think it has a lot of really, the messaging in that song is, I think, significant. And I think, well, I've heard Phil say that they included it on the archive, the RKIVE record that came out, where each of the members of Genesis got to put a few songs of their own choosing, and he chose Wake Up Call because he felt it was kind of overlooked at the time. And I really like the video. I think it's quite clever. You guys wanted to shoot elsewhere, but he got his way. You told me you presented three budgets to try to dissuade him.
we wanted to do it in LA, and he wanted to do it in Geneva. And so we kind of tried to compromise with London. And I did budgets for all three. And the Geneva one was the highest, and that's the one he chose.
He got his way, which was great. And I thought it was, you know, clever with the alarm clock and you know, Geneva time and all of that. It was a very clever tie-in. And when the character wakes up in bed, the model train is there. And I know you're tying it to the train station, but Phil is also quite a model train enthusiast. Did that play into it?
Yeah, that was one of the reasons that we did it. He's a huge... As a lot of people are. I mean, like Rod Stewart is, Neil Young.
I didn't know that.
So yeah. Rod Stewart has like an amazing setup in his house, apparently. But yeah, so that was something. And I had the idea for the Rube Goldberg-like thing. And I just, you know, I said to our Swiss production manager, you know, what do you, and he said, I actually know somebody who does these. And that was like, oh my God, that was just one of those lucky, lucky things that somebody already had. And I think as you noticed, that you said to me, it's like, it's very Python-esque, it is. I am influenced by Monty Python a lot. And the idea of these sandwich boards, all these people, you know, which is something you used to see in London. I don't know if you do anymore, but you used to see these people with sandwich boards and it would say, you know, the end is nigh, prepare to meet thy doom, you know, all that kind of stuff. And so I thought, what about if we had, you know, all these sandwich board men, that he was just one of in the middle of the song where they all go to the cafe. And it was like just silly. It was just silly that there would be a cafe where all the sandwich board guys in Geneva go to.
Right. No.
And then when we had the thing in the middle, again, we had, you know, fun and Easter eggs where people are asking him questions.
Do we need to open both eyes or just one?
What will we see?
Is it a secret?
Did something happen on the way to heaven?
Give us a clue.
Give us a sign.
Give us a miracle.
All we need is a miracle.
Is Genesis getting back together?
Which was, you know, again, it's like Life of Brian, Monty Python, you know, and people are asking, you know, and then they end up saying, oh, all we need is a miracle, which is obviously a reference to Mike Rutherford's song.
Right.
And so I had this line, which all the questions they were asking him, and then I thought, wouldn't it be fun if you had Tony Smith saying, is Genesis going to get back together? Because at that time, there was no plan to. And he declined to do it. So again, it felt to me to have to fill in at the last minute. And then Phil just rolls his eye. But 4 years later, they were together again.
There they were. And it was a great tour too. 2007 was fantastic. At the end of the video, when he's in getting his tea, he does sing the lines, and does them straight to camera. He looks right into the camera. Was that his design or yours? Because I think it makes a big impact. I'm very moved by the lyrics of that song. And, you know, he says, this is your wake up call. And then he looks away and then you're going to miss it all. And he looks, does direct address to camera.
Yes, this is a wake up call.
I don't think Phil ever said to us, let's, you know, on anything, let's do it this way. You know, he's just a natural performer.
Mm-hmm. So he knew it was the right.
We're not talking about Genesis videos now, but if you look at I Can't Dance, you know, I mean, a lot of that him to camera is all him.
Yeah. You
know, he just knows we've got a camera on him. And if he turns and he gives a look, that look, it's gold.
Okay, so we're done with video questions. And I'm going to just cruise through a couple quick questions I ask all my podcast guests. But would you say that you have a favorite Phil Collins solo song?
Well, obviously, I mean, Take Me Home means a lot to me, as I tell you before, because it's like, it's just a reminder of a wonderful time that we had, you know, all over the world.
Yeah.
I would have to say my favorite song of his is In the Air Tonight.
Okay.
Just a great, great song.
Spectacular song. It's groundbreaking and it changed music.
Yeah.
It really did. I don't know if Hugh Padgham had a little bit to do with it, but it's a great song. How about, this is funny, I ask all my podcast guests this, but asking you is a bit odd because you made them. What's your favorite Phil video?
Well, God, I mean, Phil solo video?
Yeah, solo.
Well, I think, you know, again, I can't really knock Take Me Home, but I'd say Don't Lose My Number is probably my favorite.
Yeah.
Because we got to do so much that we really wanted, all different styles of stuff, and cover a lot of bases.
That was a great video. Good one. Would you say that you preferred, I don't think you probably would go see him very often as an audience member, I wouldn't guess. But would you prefer seeing Phil as a solo performer, or would you prefer to see him with Genesis?
That's like saying, which is your favorite child?
Favorite kid. And that's what I wrote, I think. Yeah. You can't do it.
You can't do it. I don't go to see anything in the audience, really, because just having worked so intimately with the acts, it's, to be sitting 60 rows back is absurd, so I don't. I went to see one of, I went to see the Sirius, or was it Both Sides? I forget. The one that had the set, which was like a rooftop.
Where it was garbage cans.
Exactly, yeah.
Where that's Both Sides, 94, yeah.
I went to see that in the audience, but I normally don't, be just because, maybe it's just arrogance or petulance. But so there was this time when the Who were doing Tommy at the amphitheater, right?
I was there at Universal Amphitheater. I was at
yeah.
that show.
Yeah. Oh, so Jim and I went. We actually bought tickets, $500 a piece.
Yeah.
And when we go, we are seated kind of way back and right behind the crane. And I said to Jim, boy, is this kind of like poetic justice or karma? What is this? We've put cranes in audiences for so long and ruined other people's shows. And there we are, $500 a ticket, and we're sitting here behind the fucking crane. And then right before the show started, somebody came up and said, come with me. And they put us in the front row.
No way.
Yes. I mean, and I think it was because they just didn't have people there, and they decided, we can't wait. We've got to start filming this or whatever. I know if they were. Okay, yeah, they were. So there we were in the front row, right in front of Giant Muslim. So needless to say, when Phil comes on as Uncle Ernie and he looks down and he sees us, he's like, huh? That's a good enough reason not to be in the audience.
Question. Even though you guys were the FFC, the fucking film crew, did you ever get any of the end of tour gifts that Hit and Run or Phil or Tony Smith would give? I know there's a music box and a carousel and any of that neat stuff. Was that ever given to you guys, or was that not for you?
No, we got platinum records for our things. Yeah. I've still got the one from the Sirius tour.
Oh, so cool.
So yeah, we just got the platinum records.
Yeah, that's not a bad gift.
But you've got to remember, it's like getting a presence from things like that. That's meaningless, because the big present is the fact that you did it, that you've got the memories, you've got the experiences, of working with, a genius. And documenting what they're doing. So, the fact that you get given a platinum record and all that stuff, it's nice. But the real thing is is the memories that you take away from that.
Could you possibly pick out a favorite moment or experience that you had with him, whether it was working or privately, where he said something special, something that you could share with us?
Well, I think as I told you before, when he drew us aside at the No Jacket Required end of tour party in Australia, and he just basically said to us how much he appreciated what we did. We didn't discuss Another Day in Paradise, but just to give you an example of they wanted to do a video, but he didn't have time. And we said, look, well, we'll come to LA, don't have time. LA, don't have time. New York. And he said, I can give you an hour. And we said, we'll take it. And we got the video with the parts with him shot in an hour. Really, an hour out the door.
It's unbelievable.
And that was, to me, that's us saying, we got you covered. You know, we got your back.
Yeah.
And, you know, the rest of that was, you know, actually Jim played the piano parts and the guitar parts and, you know, but literally we knew, and we knew how to work fast and we knew what we wanted to get. So we literally could do all his parts in an hour and get him out of there. And I think he appreciated that. He knows that, you know, we were there for him. We were always trying to do the very best for him. And he knew it and he appreciated it and he told us so. And that is amazing. We had a relationship with him and with the Genesis guys that you could only wish for, that you had with people, especially stars, that you could have that kind of an intimate relationship where you were just so at home with each other and you could say anything and, you know, so on and so forth.
Best thing about Phil Collins, the performer?
He gives 100% every time. He never, ever does not. I mean, that's a strange thing, but he just gives his all every time.
Yeah, it's amazing. And he is. Yeah, you know, to see him on the Not Dead Yet tour, even though he has to perform seated, which I suspect is difficult in terms of singing, right? I mean, he can do it. But, you know, I think when people, even the horrible media that were so nasty to him for so many years, saw him out, you know, really out there, I think it made people say, okay, you know, this guy really cares about the music and the fans. So anyway, how about best thing about Phil Collins, the human being, the person that you knew that was the human?
I think his sense of humor.
Mm.
You know, he was always quick to laugh at himself. You know, he didn't have any kind of like, I must be seen in this light, I don't do, you know, there's a lot of people who are very protective of their image. Phil was like, what you see is what you get.
Yeah.
You know, as you said, when on the Take Me Home, he just showed up in the clothes, the floor wardrobe, whatever he wanted to do. And so the thing about Phil, no pretensions, absolutely right. No pretensions, no ego, no, you know, I'm sure there's some things where he might think, oh, well, there's been some slight stunt to him over his career, but by and large, you know, he's somebody who and he also gives back. I mean, his friendship with Lamont Dozier was literally, he loves Motown. He loves all that kind of music. And he wanted to include those people in his career. And it gave them assistance. So I think, yeah, his humility, but his sense of humor and his self-deprecation. It's like he's a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful guy.
Yeah. You're lucky to have known him. You're very fortunate, I think. And he's lucky to have known you as well. Truly. So, really. The last two questions, do you still keep in touch at all?
I haven't for a long while. Just things haven't come that way. I'm sure that, you know, if something comes up in the future that might need it, I think we'll just pick up exactly where we left off.
Yeah.
I mean, every time I see Phil, it's like the same hug. And, you know, he's always complaining that I still have my hair.
I love how Tony Banks and Phil have that rapport where Tony calls him short and bald. You know, Tony Banks is funny. We have to definitely have Paul part two and talk about Genesis.
Well, have you seen the Genesis commercials we made for Virgin Airlines?
Oh, God, those are fantastic. Yes, they're so funny. No, I wrote all the songs.
The good ones.
I wrote all the good ones. Oh, that's great.
You see, the thing about Genesis is that we're like a team, like a happy family.
Oh, I do all the writing.
I do all the writing? Yes, the good stuff. I write all the good stuff.
Sorry, no comment.
And tonight we fly to London.
Of course, we'll fly on Virgin.
And I really like the in-flight entertainment, you know. It's really sophisticated.
I always have to explain the cartoons to Phil.
It's embarrassing.
I mean, what kind of airline would call itself Virgin, anyway?
No, I mean, you know, when they get together, I mean, if we talk about the Genesis videos, and we've made some great ones, you know, like Jesus, He Knows Me. I mean, they love doing, I mean, dress them up, put them in frocks, as we say. Not, I don't literally mean frocks. They would love it. And even Tony Banks.
He's the best. I loved his wig in Jesus, He Knows Me. It fit right. He looked like it, you know, was his hair. It was funny.
He was one wearing a wig.
He wasn't? It was really his hair?
No, I had to go back and look at that.
Edit that out because
I think
Tony Banks sees that.
For some of that. But yeah, no, I mean, even with Genesis and with Mike and the Mechanics, you know, we've had nothing but fun. I mean, they are great, great guys, and
delightful.
They do phenomenal music. I mean, I listen to Genesis every day.
Me too. Yeah. We have that common.
You know, I just love listening to that stuff. You know, it's come to an end. I'm sad, but probably that's all things have to.
Yeah. As you know, I started this campaign called Get Phil Voted In, because I think it's an egregious oversight that Phil has not been recognized for his significant contribution to music as a solo artist. And it is significant. And I wonder if you've had any time to think about, I know you knew this question ahead of time, if you can identify what maybe his most significant contribution to music as a solo artist is.
Well, I think that Phil is a very unique artist in that he combines his own original material, but will also embrace the music of the past that he loves and respects. And he needs to be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame just simply because you cannot touch his achievements as a solo artist. The amount of albums sold, the amount of tickets sold, you just can't touch it. So it's an inevitable thing that he will be in there, and the sooner the better.
Well said. Thank you so much, Paul Flattery, for your time. I know it was a long interview, but thank you. Yes, this is a-